fell to the ground and began to plead with him, saying, "Have patience with me, and I will repay you." But he was unwilling, and went and threw him in prison until he should pay back what was owed. So when his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were deeply grieved and came and reported to the Lord all that had happened. Then, summoning him, his Lord said to him, "You wicked slave, I forgave you all that your debt because you played with me. Should you not also have mercy on your fellow slave in the same way that I have mercy on you?"
Yes.
And his Lord, moved with anger, handed him over to the torturers until he should repay all that was owed. "My heavenly Father, we also do the same to you if each of you does not forgive his brother from your heart."
Amen.
Amen. We have to forgive so that even our communication can demonstrate divine grace. As we also learn from Colossians 4:6, "Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that ye may know how ye ought to answer every man." Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, so that ye may know how ye ought to answer every man. As leaders and believers, we must understand that speech has force, and force has energy to hurt or to heal. We must endeavor at all times to control our emotions and don't spontaneously react when we feel threatened or when we feel provoked. If we are in Christ Jesus, no matter what, we must realize we are here as ambassadors for Christ and hence must never drive all the good people that God has planted in our midst to recoil back in their shell for fear of being misunderstood, since they know that it is a folly to be wise where ignorance is bliss. The essential meaning of grace in the Bible refers to the nature of God's character to exercise goodwill towards his creatures. And this nature finds its supreme expression in Jesus Christ. By its very definition, this grace is fully accessible to all humans with no other condition than a desire to repent and receive it. And the book of Titus 2:11-12 confirms it. It reads, "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world."
Amen.
On the other hand, if we refuse his divine grace, we distance ourselves from his throne of grace. The tragic alternative to receiving God's grace is to remain in hopeless alienation or to pursue futile attempts to earn God's favor, as the Bible warned us in Romans 1:21-22. "For even though they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks, but they became futile in their speculation, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools."
Yes.
Christ represents the fulfillment, the embodiment, and the dispenser of divine grace. In fact, the early Christians freely referred to God's grace as the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. This grace was conceived as being so basic to their existence that they combined the traditional Greek of shalom, which is peace, with a reference to the grace of Jesus Christ. And this is the reason for the basic Greek formula found in almost every book of the New Testament, as we also read in 2 Thessalonians 3:18. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with each and every one of you, now and forevermore.
Amen.
May God bless you all.